face. Okay, we're rolling. Tony Jackson, 1991. 18 years of getting older. Now a dead man on the run. Isn't love a funny thing with a pistol in your hand? Close your eyes and bow your head. Pray if you can. Why you seal your fate when you pick up that shotgun? 18 years of getting older. Now a dead man on the run. 18 years of growing older. Now a dead man on the run. On the run.
You ready? Okay.
It didn't matter, Tommy Jackson was running free. Okay. I think we're in the mix. Let's bring this over so we can see.
You ready?
Yeah.
What's that?
Okay, so what you want to try out the new segments? You got what you're going to say for things I wish my party would have thought of, what the other party's thinking of, and bad optics. You got something for that?
Yeah, the lion.
Okay. And what about the things I wish the other party's thinking about that I wish we would have thought about? Things, something that the other party's doing that...
Okay.
Okay, you ready? Okay, let's start out with the poll.
I don't have enough to say about that, but okay.
Okay. 3, 2, 1. Welcome back to the Bullsheet. I'm Chase Wilson.
I'm Joel Williams.
Poor People's Advocate here with me again today. It's been a while, almost a month, since the White House was a rainbow flag, and I think that's the last time we were here.
Obergefell versus Hodges?
Yeah, not a whole lot's gone on in the realm of breaking Supreme Court news since that time, but a lot of stuff going on. We are 9 months from the start of primaries for... the presidential election coming up in 2016. Is it hard to believe that it's almost the end of Obama?
I am really surprised. I'm loving that Obama's coming out of his shell. He realizes that he has nothing to lose, and he's coming out gunning. Today I heard that he ordered, he wants 300 supercomputers to be the fastest ever. So he's kind of like John F. Kennedy's put a man on the moon before the end of the decade is out. It is a shot across the bow to China, who is now ascending in their tech capabilities for supercomputing.
So Obama's coming out of his shell. Republicans are playing a shell game with their nominee.
Just 1 week away, less than a week actually, to the first debates on Fox News, and this will be 10 of the GOP.
Can we go ahead and call it what it really is? The great Cole, you know.
The Cole brothers, Koch brothers?
No, I mean, like, we're going to Cole, like, half the candidates.
Oh, yes. If you don't, yeah, what Chase is saying is so true. If you don't make the cut, if you're not on the Fox National debate, there's really no chance that you're going to have a viable shot at becoming the GOP candidate.
Unless, I explained to Joel, I still think there's one candidate that has not announced yet. And that when he does, I think he will immediately be the front runner, in my opinion. And I'm obviously speaking about Mr. Magic Underwear himself, Mitt Romney.
Mitt Romney. Now, I always thought that Mitt Romney was a very centrist Republican. I thought he had a lot of appeal in the Latino community. I think he pulled well when he went down to Univision and did that, put on that darker makeup and did the interview with Univision. But he's a likable guy, and he's a real guy. And Chase was enlightening me to a video that they is, I think, now available on Netflix.
Yeah, his Netflix documentary.
And like him or love him, you know, I'm not a big fan of the GOP politics, but like him or love him, Mitt Romney is a real nice human being. He's a decent human being.
More personality than I think.
And he's a good man. He's a family man. And I think the big question, and this goes back, this harkens back to the 1950s with President Kennedy. The big question is, are evangelical Christians willing to accept a Mormon and you know, this fundamentally different doctrine that the Mormons have? You know, the Church of Latter-day Saints is known for believing that Jesus Christ came to America in the 19th century and spoke to Joseph Smith, which is heretical to many evangelical Christians. They think it is blasphemy. So there is an issue.
You know, there is the issue of the different doctrines, and then there's the issue of the bad taste that was left in a lot of the nation's breadbasket Bible Belt, particularly Missouri, where we're at, from that, the John Smith and what all happened here in right around the early 20th century.
Literally burned them out of town, and they were, Mormons were not well liked, and left with mobs chasing them with flames. So
they hopped on the Oregon Trail, they shocked their wagon and forded the river. For you millennials out there, you'll get that reference. But Joel sitting here looking at me like he has no
clue. I'm a deer in the headlights on that reference. You got me on.
They did not die of dysentery, which. I'm obviously speaking of the childhood game we all played, Oregon Trail.
Oh, Oregon Trail! I love that game. I would always get poisoned because I'd pick the wrong flower.
So,
I love that game.
But we've got a lot to talk about on the Republican side.
A lot to talk about. Now, okay, what's so surprising, and I think Chase will agree with me on this, is the GOP front runner now is Donald Trump, and this guy is a bomb thrower. I mean, he is essentially disintegrating the party from the inside out. And why I think this is so important for the Republican Party, the GOP in general, is because we look at the demographics. The fact of the matter is the U.S. Census is reporting that the predominant Latinos are going to be the predominant race, I guess, if you will, for lack of a better term, by 2030. And this means that, you know, we haven't not elected, re-elected a president since Herbert Walker Bush. We have a tendency, if history proves right, we will re-elect whoever is elected the president in 2016. We will re-elect them.
The devil we know is always better than the devil we know.
Right. I mean, it's true with Obama, it's true with Bush, it's Clinton. I mean, it's a sure thing. And so the point I'm trying to make is the demographics say that Latinos are outpacing white Americans. They're having 4 babies to 1. And that the 13 big states that now are solidly red, you know, basically, if you took a map of the U.S. Confederacy in 1861 and you overlaid it over the GOP now, the strongholds, pretty much be the same thing. Georgia, Alabama, Florida, Arkansas, Missouri, Tennessee, Virginia, West Virginia, you know, pretty much the same thing. And those states are ironically where a lot of the illegal immigration, the undocumented workers, I prefer to call them, are taking up residence. So what that means is that when the biggest demographic shift that I think is important is most of them are under 18 right now. And if Hillary Clinton gets into office, she gets a second election, she wins that second term, those kids that are now in those states are going to be of voting age. The GOP is done, effectively. as a national party, they will never be able to get another president. Sure, they'll do okay in strong Republican states, regionally, like they are now. They're doing really well, control both sides of the House. They do real well regionally, but a national election, that is going to be, this, that's why this election 2016 is going to be so crucial. They got to win. If they don't win this, they're going to have to do a 180-degree turn on so many policies. They're going to have to do course correction. They're going to have to say, okay, we're going to give up on abortion. Okay, we're going to give up on sending our military overseas to fight every war. So the point I'm trying to make is that if the GOP doesn't win this election, they're going to be done as a national party as we know them, the party of no, the party that is always saying, you know, no to health care, no to freedom of choice for women, choice, what do you call, pro-choice, no to abortion, no to legalizing marijuana, no to giving amnesty to undocumented workers that have been here for years, no to euthanasia, people who want to choose to opt out of life because of some disabling illness. No to in climate change, in understanding and trying to investigate ways to reduce sulfur gas emissions. The party of no, as we know it, is going to be the party of maybe. And Jeb Bush, I think, right now, with his coming out and saying that he is in support of climate change science, that to me indicates that the GOP gets it, that they understand that there is an existential threat to them over the long term, especially with Latino voters, who will be the new majority in 2025. I think Jeb Bush gets it, and I think the other Donald Trump for sure does not get it.
So, the Bush is the moderate right now, right? But I think we've talked about Romney, we've talked about Bush, we've talked about Trump. The one I'm interested in seeing was here in Missouri last week, Scott Walker.
I don't like him because he's anti-union.
He is, and he's anti-legalization.
I'm a big pro. I think the war on drugs is a loser. It's the same. If you look back at the Volstead Act and the way that we banned alcohol and how that gave rise to the mafia, I think the similarities are almost directly parallel to what we're seeing south of the border with the Zetas cartel and the Sinaloa cartel. They would not have come to ascendancy if they had not been able to produce a product and sell it illegally here in America at our expense. And I think the war on drugs, you know, we're spending $50,000 a year to house somebody in a federal prison for transporting marijuana. I think it's a waste of money, it's a waste of resources. I think those resources could be better spent on retraining people. This idea that if you commit a felony when you're 20, marks you for the rest of your life, there's no way to work out of it, that you're always gonna be at a disadvantage, that's ridiculous from a public policy point of view. And most, especially for non-violent crimes like trafficking marijuana, I think that, you know, those people need, if they've kept their nose clean after 7 years, why, just like your credit, why not wipe that off their credit? Why not get rid of that? If you have not reoffended within 7 years, if I were Rand Paul or one of these, maybe Ted Cruz or one of these Republicans that are on the bubble, like we said, if they don't make that cut of 10 come next Friday, they're out. That's it. There's no more. If I was John Kasich or what's the black one from Florida? Ben Carson. If I were them, I would be pushing amnesty, or I'm gonna say amnesty. Let's call it expungement of your felony record for marijuana, nonviolent drug possession, drug trafficking, where there's no gun, no weapon involved. You do 7 years. You serve your jail time. You pay your fine. You do your substance abuse program. You have not reoffended. Boom! It comes off your record. Now that doesn't mean that you're not still a convicted felon, but it means that you will never be able to be denied for applying for a job or a home loan or other things that right now is, I think is it's forcing this criminal class, this permanent criminal class. What choice do you have? If you can't get a good job, what's the incentive for you to go out there and try to work at McDonald's? You might as well just go back to slinging rocks or whatever you were doing. I do
see some of the policies that have led to what they call them career criminals.
It's ridiculous from a societal point. Get them back into the workplace so we can tax them, so they can be productive people, and we can use those taxes for building roads and schools and other things.
Get those cogs back to work.
Yes.
Enough about the Republicans.
You don't want to talk about Mike Huckabee and his Obama is pushing Israel to the gates of the oven, the doors of the oven.
Well,
with his Iran policy.
Mike Huckabee and I are not friends, so I don't really care to talk about him. I think the fact that he's still around speaks to his fans more than it speaks to his like-minded politics. But I think he will be around longer than people think he should be, though.
He's got a lot of support from the evangelical, especially down in Arkansas, Missouri area. Seeing real popular, ironically, in New Hampshire. Polls well in New Hampshire, which I found fascinating.
I think he will. I think he will continue to be a factor, but I think he's more a he's more the straw that's stirring the drink rather than the drink itself.
So, who do you like, Walker?
I think Walker's probably at this point your nominee, but
Jeb Bush is going to be hard to beat.
Jeb Bush.
He's got the Latino popular. He's married to a Latino woman. He speaks Spanish. He's at least acknowledging climate change, which is a fundamental shift for the GOP in general. I'm not aware of any other GOP candidate that's ever even said that man-made gases are actually responsible.
I mean, he's a moderate. I mean, I know it's Hillary against the world right now.
Right. The polls say that even the best Republican out of this group could never be Bernie Sanders, who is, for the uninitiated, still 14 points, I think, below Hillary. So
I think that those polls are awesome. You got to remember, Obama's first election, the polls at this point in time, you know, after he announced, had him running away with it so largely.
That's true.
And we ended up having an under 1% race.
I like this channel. It's called Real Clear Politics. It looks at 5 or 6 polls. ABC Washington Post poll, PPP, which is, I think, the PowerPoint yeah. something, Fox News poll.
It's the Democrat poll.
CNN. Yeah. It's got Rasmussen, and it's got the Quinnipiac poll. So I think it's a pretty comprehensive poll. Right now they got Trump leading, I think, by 14 points over the next or 20.8% of the electorate say they will vote for the GOP electorate say they will vote for Trump. Walker is sitting at 13.7. Jeb Bush is at 12.2. Marco Rubio 6.8. I mean, that's a significant drop right there when you see between Bush and Rubio. What I find really surprising here is Ted Cruz is on the bubble. Ted Cruz, the senator from Texas, famous for saying that President Obama is not a citizen, that he's a birther. He's a firm believer that President Obama was not born in America, is really roiled the politics. He really upset the Republican leadership, with especially John Boehner in the House and Mitch McConnell in the Senate, not a fan of them, and is very outspoken against his own party. He's a Harvard grad, Canadian, born in Canada, but his parents are Cuban immigrants. This guy, I'm really surprised to see that he is literally on the bubble behind candidates like Ben Carson. I found that fascinating.
I think, like I said, I think your top four are really probably going to pull away after this debate, because they're obviously all going to be there. Romney's a wild card. What does he decide to do? What does he not decide? I mean, I think he's still sitting on a pretty good chunk of PAC money, one way or the other. So his support could push somebody forward. And who knows, maybe this time, you know, he said publicly, he promised his wife that was the last time he'd run for president. But who knows, maybe suddenly we see him as a running mate or you know, that's something that always interests me is...
Who will be the vice? Who will be the president?
Because and that's not something the Republican Party's ever had a lot of, but the Democrat Party in the past is, you've heard them announce vice presidential candidates or running mates earlier, even before the primary is decided, in hopes of swaying...
Al Gore, classic example.
In hopes of swaying votes. The Republican Party's never really partaken in that.
Sarah Palin...
she was after the nomination, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wonder if this isn't the election we see the Republicans jump on board and start using a little bit of that. And for a guy like Walker, like you talked about, a Yankee as far as most of us here in the...
But he rides a Harley Davidson, and that has a lot of appeal in the South. And
that may be, but I think at some point, you know, he's got to get votes down there. So do we suddenly see him go grab like a... Louisiana Governor Bobby
Jindal?
I'm just saying names right now. Nothing pointing this direction. But what could help him in his case?
I really thought, you know, just from the optics, Chase Dog and I, we do a lot of optics. We're interested in what what would they call the PR aspect of politics. And for optics, for me, there's no better looking GOP guy than Rick Perry, the senator former governor from Texas. I mean, this guy, when he put on those glasses, didn't his IQ jump about 20 points? He looks very presidential. And this is for history buffs. When we look back at Warren Harding, here's a guy who looked the role. Terrible president, but he looked the role. And people saw, he was tall, very handsome. He fit the prototypical, what Americans would like to see as the president. And I think what we're dealing with here with Bobby Jindal is and other senator presidential candidates are optics problems. Bobby Jindal looks like he might be the page boy for they made fun of him being the page from NBC's 30 Rock, Kenneth, they call him. And then the way that Marco Rubio was sipping his water, these are what we call optics. And how they're perceived in
poor Marco Rubio. I mean,
with the sipping the water,
the dude just needed a drink, guys. It's stressful being on national television. But the dude needed a drink.
But that is a case study in why optics are important in politics. And that's so Chase Dobb and I have a new segment. We call it Bad Optics, and so this is a good transition. Things that may be innocuous, mean nothing. But when the way they're perceived have a very deep meaning and can affect politics in a big way.
I think I'm going to go with the number one story in the world right now, and that's Cecil the Lion.
I think it's Cecil.
Cecil?
Yeah, I think that's what
it is. Cecil?
Yeah.
Sorry, Cecil the Lion. Like, what is that ridiculous number we see every year from UNICEF? Like 20 million kids in Africa die a year.
It's amazing.
We're worried about a lion. Mm-hmm. We're worried about a lion. Like, there was a movie when I was growing up called The Lion King.
Yes.
It's a very popular Disney film where a lion dies and then the brother tries to kill the, you know, because they're going to take over the pride. We're worried about a flipping lion, and there's 20 million kids in Africa that die annually of largely preventable.
This is a classic case of optics. Jimmy Kimmel, the comedian that does the Jimmy Kimmel Show late night, got on national TV and exposed this Minnesota dentist who spent $55,000, I think, to fly to Africa and hired a team of guides to essentially bait a lion that was being tracked through GPS monitoring around his neck by the University of Oxford University in England. They drew him off of the game preserve. The hunter, using a bow and arrow, shot an arrow at Cecil the Lion, injured the lion, but did not kill it. And what followed
was not a clean kill.
40-hour hunt, which culminated with them shooting the lion.
Can I just point one thing out? Like, the only tracking that's taken longer than this lion was when those two dudes escaped from prison. I mean, like, you know, there's varying levels of expertise in hide and seek, and there's like DB
master level,
DB Cooper level. You know, just under DB Cooper level is like Osama bin Laden level.
40 hours. That's like a work week, seriously. And you got an arrow in you. And at any rate, it culminated with this lion being shot with a pistol, I believe, and then they decapitated the lion.
That's my favorite part of the whole story. It's like, we tracked this mother effer for a week. They were so mad at this stinking thing. They're like, we just want the head. We just want to be done with this sucker. We don't want to have to carry it back. Let's cut the head off.
And then they tried to destroy the GPS monitor, which obviously, like Tom Brady destroying his phone during Deflategate, it just hollers guilt.
Yeah.
I mean, he's trying to say that he was unaware but come on, bro.
Here's my deal. Okay. We've got legal backgrounds, and like, we've seen people post bail or post bond several times, and on occasion the judge will order that they be monitored by GPS tracking bracelets. Like, those dudes step like 3 feet past the line they're allowed to go, and like, there's cops everywhere. Mm-hmm. This lion is just, for a week, walking around.
No, I say 40 hours. I think they did it over, like, I mean, it was 40 consecutive hours. It wasn't like a full work week.
Whether it was a full work week or 2 days, yeah, it doesn't matter. This lion is essentially walking around for 2 days with an arrow stuck out of the side of it. What kid sitting back at the college going, what is this lion doing?
Yeah.
You know, like, he's never been here before.
Watching the trace patterns on the GPS. And so the call has come out. Zimbabwe is roiling mad. I mean, they are hopping mad. They are calling for this dentist who has, by the way, a history of big game hunting. There's photos of him on the internet posed next to cheetahs and jaguars. And this is what this guy does. He's a big game hunter.
Well, and he had, in the past, been issued a poaching ticket in, I believe it was Wisconsin or Minnesota.
In his defense, you know, and I'm four sets of the line, but in his defense, when you're hunting some animals, the male and female are so
indistinguishable
from far away that, I'm not an apologist for this guy, but I'm just saying, let's be cautious before we stamp him with poacher.
No, I don't, here's the deal. I'm obviously gun rights. I hunt, personally, I hunt. I don't have a problem with it. Here's where the sportsman and hunter in me just starts laughing at the fact that in order to harvest this animal, you had to go to a grocery store.
They put steak on the back of a truck.
And you're like, when you go in the grocery store, like, you go to the butcher and you're like, hey, I need a steak.
What do you want, ribeye?
Yeah, you want ribeye? What do you want? Tri-tip? You want strip steak? It was for a lion. What are lions like? I mean, that's my question. Is what butcher goes, you know what? They've been having a lot of luck with that sirloin over there. Let me get you a couple pounds of that sirloin. Or better yet, if you're that butcher, you sell him the most ridiculous steak you've ever even heard of. Oh, I got just what you need. Or it's called the pride cut. Specifically for lions. It's the pride cut. He comes out with some mashed up brisket, you know. I really think it's funny to me that they went, when you hunt, literally, you need two things. You need the gun and you need the bullet. And that's it. If you got to go out and grocery shop for for what you're trying to hunt,
you know it's illegal. You know you're breaking the law.
Well, I don't know about breaking the law, but I think I'd step back and go, wait a minute.
Exactly.
I buy steaks for my buddies.
Yeah.
You know, and so I think that's where I don't necessarily think that what he did was illegal, and obviously that's just my opinion, but
Zimbabwe is calling for an extradition of this guy. He's a multi-millionaire dentist. He had to shutter his shop. Woody Allen's wife, Mia Farrow, went on Twitter and exposed his address. Literally, is in hot water. I think the FBI is looking into it. She went on and posted his physical address of his home. And you know, these PETA people and these animal rights people, they are bomb throwers, literally. You know, I mean, this guy is hired professionals to protect him now.
I think, here's where, like, again, my bad optics is, and maybe I'm wrong and this event will draw attention to helping these game preserves and wildlife preserves in protecting endangered animals. But one thing, lions aren't endangered. That is fact. That is knowledge. I'm sure Cecil the Lion was a great lion, and I'm sure his friends are missing him.
Here's the blowback. Lions, the way they act is when the male is killed, the other male lions will kill the children.
Yeah.
And Cecil's two children now are at risk from being destroyed by other...
I mean, can we call Child Protective Services?
Can
we get DFS on this? Because do they have a Lions Division of Family Services? Like, those are my friends that went to school for zoology. Are you a DFS worker for Lions now? Please don't come after me.
Are you
going to
get Cecil's children relocated?
Yeah, I mean, can we find a foster lion family? I can't do it. I can't see his face. But my bad optics is... Cecil the Lion. Okay. It's not as bad as it seems. I'm sorry that the lion lost his life, but Africa's got bigger issues than a lion.
Okay. Good point. My bad optics this week is the Ayatollah Khomeini, actually it's Khatami, I think, posted a Twitter image on his Twitter website of President Obama, a figure that in silhouette that looks very much like President Obama holding a gun to his head, and the caption reads something like, if there is a war, America, we certainly don't welcome war, but if America brings war to our doorstep, then we will finish it, basically. We're not running away from war. This type of saber rattling, I think, is terrible optics here in America, but in Iran, going back to what we're talking about, optic, here you have a government, basically, is predicated on the 1979 revolution, where Ayatollah Khomeini overthrew the Shah, who was favorable to America, and they hold rallies weekly that where they're burning the American flag and they're saying death to America. He has to do these types of things in order to save face in his country, because he's literally making a deal with the devil in their mind. They consider the United States this great Satan. But it's terrible optics here in America because he chose to use Twitter. If he had used the Iranian version of the YouTube or whatever the social media is popular there, he'd probably been fine. But here in America, there's a lot of pushback against John Kerry and the State Department going over there and basically doing an end run around the Senate and the confirmation process and getting the UN a 15-0 vote, I might add, a unanimous vote from the rest of the world that this deal should go through, that there should be a way to lift the sanctions against Iran, and in exchange for that, we get to minimize their ability to create fissile material and work on their nuclear program. But the bad optics of this week, I think it's terrible, is that for many Americans that were on the fence, that were like, well, maybe they're going to turn the corner like Cuba. There can be some rapprochement, some detente, if you will. I think when they see the image of President Obama holding a gun to his head and they're talking the smack, talking real greasy, real reckless at the mouth, I think it takes the flavor out of a lot of what the progress that has been done on that treaty.
Little unknown fact, the Iranian version of YouTube is Shiite Tube. But I think most Americans, at least where we are in the Midwest, are very leery of any deal with Iran. And I think a lot of that is there is a very large portion of our area that is very sympathetic to Israel.
Right.
And that's always been the fear, is
that Israel will wipe them off the map.
And there's been promises of that. Yeah. And so it's not an unfounded fear, but I think it's an... what was that movie? War Games with Matthew Broderick back in like 1984.
Wow, you're reaching deep into the memory bank.
And basically the
do you want to play a game?
The synopsis of the movie is that there is no winner in thermonuclear war.
The first country that uses a nuke, all of the other countries have to destroy it.
But
because it is the rabid dog in the community.
But I guess
you don't know what they're... If they're that crazy that they're going to destroy millions of people indiscriminately, you have no option but to put that down. And so that has been the nuclear deterrent.
My fear isn't that Iran would actually use a nuke on Israel. My fear is, and this is largely ignorance of America, most likely, is I don't know that Iran has the security and stability to, once they do have those nuclear weapons, to track them efficiently enough for me to believe that somebody couldn't sneak one out of a facility, sneak it into Israel.
I think Iran right now, is going to be the largest Shia Muslim country in the world. And for the uninitiated, Iran is now boots on the ground, spearheading our effort against ISIS in many parts of Iraq. They are losing troops daily, like we were losing troops when we went into Fallujah. I mean, the body count for Iran is high. And we are relying on them because our country is literally war-weary. We exhausted our treasury for war in Iraq and Afghanistan, and we simply, I don't think the American people will support another war this soon after getting out of those two, being embroiled in those two wars. We need Iran to do the dirty work for us. Now what Chase is saying is true. They have a very powerful military. Their navy is stepping up. But here's the deal. They have just taken receipt of some very sophisticated Russian surface-to-air missiles. Now, in the past, Israel has bombed nuclear reactors within Iran twice, Natanz and Shiraz. They have literally flown jets, blew them up to try to halt their nuclear program. With these new missiles, these are fourth or fifth generation missiles. These are very hard to defeat surface-to-air missiles. Even the best pilot flying the best aircraft is going to have difficulty with it. I think Russia is really showing Iran that, hey, we want these sanctions to work, but if they don't, you now can protect your nuclear arsenal, and that's scary to me.
Well, the old sleeping lady, Mother Russia, is scary.
SA five or so, I can't remember but they're really really sophisticated missiles.
Is there a scarier person in the world than Putin?
Putin right now, they say somebody just did a Forbes thing. He's the richest person in the world.
I don't doubt that he is, but I mean, is there a scarier person in the world? Because he's like, you know, Silence of the Lambs, Hannibal Lecter. Like, he's a high functioning like sociopath.
Yeah,
So like, what day is he gonna wake up and like when he gets out of bed he's gonna step on a tack and that day he's just gonna be like, you know what? Chechnya has been a problem for like 30 years. Let's just go ahead and just do away with it. You know,
and here's the thing though. I mean, this shows the limit on here you got an absolute dictator with absolute power, and he still cannot defeat Islamic fundamentalists and his southern border.
If the United States was real honest with itself, that's probably the reason our relations with Russia are where they are. They asked for our help immediately in that deal. Mm-hmm. And we basically said, that's your deal. And so, and now here...
Were we talking about Ukraine or Chechnya?
Chechnya.
Oh, okay.
And so, and now, here we are like, hey, Russia, we need help with ISIS and ISIL. And they're like, hey, we asked for your help 25 years ago with these same people, and you're just now jumping on the board. No, we fought our turn. It's your turn now. And so,
I'm kind of, you know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. I'm kind of rooting for the Chechens in a way. You know, I mean, the fact of the matter that you have a guy who has ultimate power. I mean, literally can disappear you overnight. He can, your whole family can just disappear overnight. And they still can't get, I forgot his name. He's got a big, long beard and he's making videos. He's their version of Osama bin Laden. And they still can't get him. They try to poison him with radiation poisoning.
Yeah, Osama bin Putin is his name.
Or whatever. But this guy, he's a Chechen Muslim extremist, and they still can't defeat him. And I mean, that says something to the power of this Islamic fanatic radical group, you know. And it says something. I mean, here's a guy who can literally make you disappear and your whole family line. And you can't get this guy that is 1,800 miles away from Moscow? That says something to me.
Russia is always going to... Russian and U.S. relations are always going to be...
strained.
Yeah, at best. I'm going to regret this, but now it's time for our sports segment of the day.
Okay.
This weekend...
tomorrow.
Saturday. We'll try to get this loaded before it happens. But if not, I'll go on the record, and so will Joel on a pick here in just a second. But it's rare in sports that women dominate the headlines. We saw a couple times, we've seen at least once this summer, Women's World Cup.
Three goals! Has that ever been done in the male side?
They ended up scoring five.
No, I'm talking about one girl. She scored three.
I mean, there's been hat tricks for the U.S. before, yes. You know, the U.S. essentially just dismantling Japan. I'm not going to use the drop the bombs reference that a lot of people liked using that day. I think those are
or
payback for Pearl Harbor references.
Oh, that's
that
so
used.
Politically correct. But that happened? Oh my gosh.
Filled the day. But the women won the U.S. women won the World Cup. But we're not talking about soccer. We're talking about every guy's favorite thing in the world. When you're growing up in school or you're at the bar, there are two words that will immediately cause a mass rush of people to wherever those words originate from. And those two words are chick fight. And we've got a chick fight this weekend. We got Korea. I believe that's how you say her name.
Right.
And
Bethe Carrera.
And Ronda Rousey. I'm going to let you pick first. Ronda Rousey, a large favorite.
7-1, according to one Las Vegas bookmaker.
Who do you have?
I'm going to go with Ronda Rousey. She's American. The other gal is from Brazil. And I think they're both undefeated, and I think they both have kind of a chip on their shoulder to see who will be. I mean, that's kind of like the ultimate. If you're both undefeated, you know that somebody's got to lose, and it adds another layer to.
Well, I mean, and the crazy thing about Ronda Rousey is not that so much that even she's undefeated. It's that no one's really even come close.
Right.
You know?
Ronda Rousey is a bantamweight in MMA, but it's known. It kind of made a name for herself as the 32nd, kind of like Mike Tyson back in the day, where you'd be lucky to make it more than 1 minute.
Do you think you could last a minute with her?
No. She has she practices these submission holds where her whole gambit is not to really fight you. It's about to get you down to the ground and pin you to the point where you have to tap out.
Wouldn't you just like run in circles?
Basically, just stay away, like rope a dope, like Muhammad Ali and Larry Holmes. Just stay away from me. Yeah. Stay away from me.
Like, if she's running at you, like, what defense mechanism would you use?
Gun, knife, weapon, run.
I think back in the early 2000s, there was a very popular white comedian by the name of Dane Cook, and he had a bit about he was watching a NASCAR race on TV, and there was a wreck, and a tire flew off the car, flew up into the stands, and hit a woman and killed her.
Oh, wow.
And my favorite line of almost all comics ever is he talks about how literally everyone around her scattered. And she's sitting there, and he goes, she had the look on her face like she was going to get a slap bite with a Goodyear, you know. And like, that's what I think of, like, if I was in a ring with Ronda Rousey, like, I would just be like, no, no, stay back. You leave me alone. No, stop. Just circles. But I think you're right. I think Ronda Rousey probably wins USA.
Yeah, see, I think they're 137 pound, which is kind of big for a girl, I guess. I
wouldn't know. I don't follow MMA enough.
Really. I know, right? And that's another thing. This is going to have a cross audience appeal to it because of the fact that there's two. You mentioned the chick fight, and they're not bad looking chicks. I'm not very partial to either one physically, but they're not ugly. They're not.
You got to bang one. You got to fight one. Which one are you picking?
Rossi. Because
which one? Fight or bang?
The bang part. The other girl, her face, she just looks like a dude in the face.
Yeah, she's the fighter, so she's probably got swollen everything.
I guess that's the funny thing, is that the new NFL coach, the female that they pulled up from... She's not... I don't want to get in trouble being politically incorrect, but... she's got a very masculine jawline.
It's the Democrat that's making the comments.
Yes. She's a.
One thing that's happened since we were last together is the ESPYs.
Caitlyn Jenner debacle.
And Caitlyn Jenner.
Did she deserve?
Her name is actually his name, and his name is Bruce Jenner, but. Former decathlon gold medalist for the U.S. Wheaties box cover model
gold medal,
triple
gold.
But I would say he is now more known for winning the Arthur Ashe Award than he is for.
And there was a U.S. soldier, an African American soldier, who had lost, I think, both of his legs,
arm and a leg.
What was his sport?
It's the decathlon running and stuff like that.
I mean, this guy is an inspiration to anyone, but much less a multi paraplegic.
That story, and then you had the Lauryn Hill story, which is
the girl that suffered from brain cancer
that passed away this spring,
and played college basketball,
and raised so much awareness and so much money her story.
Who got into trouble for tweeting it?
Several did.
There was one Hollywood guy that really.
I'm not sure, but there was.
Was it J.J. Abrams or?
I don't know.
Directors got in trouble for saying they should not have overlooked these words.
And I don't think unworthy of being recognized for her plight. Although I will say, in law, Joel always reminds me of this. You can't go to the harm.
Right.
I don't know how to address this, but
the theory being is that the Arthur Ashe Award is an award given for courage, because Arthur Ashe was the first African American to play to break the barrier, really, in an all-white tennis sport, and would be chanting the N-word at him, at some of these places that he would go, and the courage that it took for him to go out there and do that. And for them to award an award based on courage in sport to Caitlyn Jenner for coming out of the closet
Well, no, she didn't come out of the closet.
What do you mean?
Because she
made that transition.
But what's it called if you're? I mean, he's not gay.
He was closeted.
Is it still coming out of the closet?
Yeah. I mean, because there was speculation on TMZ. They saw him with his fingertips painted, and there was speculation. But when he finally came out and did that, I think it was not Barbara Walters. It was the other guy.
The Vanity Fair is.
When he came out and did the interview. And which I think surprised a lot of people that he is not into men. Yeah. And he's still batting for the home team, which I think isn't that kind of a disadvantage?
I'm going to get in trouble for this. I like boobs too, but I'm not putting them on me.
I just feel like if you're committed to this, go the whole night, chop, chop. Go, you know what I'm saying?
You're right. You don't deserve the courage award until you...
Exactly! That's the ultimate mark of courage, right?
Yeah, I mean, maybe, but I think my question is, do you feel like he was more deserving than the two?
No, that's the epitome of courage. You go to Iraq, you get your arm and leg blown off and some IED. You and come back, you battle depression, you battle PTSD, you battle all this, these people, children gawking at you when you go to the store. You have the courage to get up every morning and not put a gun in your head. That is true courage.
Yeah, I agree.
And not just participate, but excel at a sport. That, to me, is courageous.
I mean, to me, and I understand that the sports aspect of it is part of it, and I saw some people, well, Lauryn Hill played, you know, Division II, Division III college basketball, so, you know, that she wasn't really an elite athlete, you know. And I guess my question to those people, is that really what the award is about? Is it
when you think about Arthur Ashe standing in front of Wimbledon at the highest peak?
I understand that what Arthur Ashe was, he was at the top. There was nobody better at a time than him, and he went through hell to get there. But to me, it's less about the sport for me than it is about the message.
Courageousness, you know, standing up to adversity.
Jim Valvano, former NC State coach, national champion for the Wolfpack, probably gave one of the most famous speeches in history, especially from a sports standpoint, when he received the Arthur Ashe Award for courage at the ESPYs, and he sat up there and talked about if you wake up every day and you laugh and you love and you cry, you've had a full day, and was encouraging people. You know, he said, your donations to the cancer research will not save my life, but it might save my son's or my daughter's. And that was the epitome of that award to me. And I think about the history of that. And then we have...
Well, I mean, you could make an argument that Caitlyn Jenner coming out and saying, you're not alone, for all the people who are questioning.
Maybe I am... Because I'll be honest, I'm turned off by the notion of transsexuals or
it's
transgender.
It's nothing new in human society.
We can't say
this is a recent development.
And I won't say that it is, but it's not for me. Yeah. And I guess my position is those other stories, they transcend everything. Mm-hmm. There is not a person in this world that can't look at a soldier returning from war with life-altering ailments and go, I owe you something. You did that for me and you don't know me. I owe you something. There's not a person in the world that hasn't had a family member or a friend affected by cancer. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's where I kind of lost the... Because the ESPYs are usually one of my favorite programs of the year.
Really?
You know, you get to relive some of the most memorable sports moments in the past year. The entertainment's usually really, really good. Mm-hmm. But I didn't watch this year because I knew Caitlyn Jenner was going to be I didn't want to be soured on that immediately. Now we'll transition. Well, actually, I got one more sports topic. And
A-Rod?
No. I'm a soccer fan, and this summer has been littered with FIFA allegations and corruption.
Step ladder.
But Have you seen the name sounds wrong. Have you seen the video of the comedian from England
throwing the money,
trying to pay Seth Blatter for North Korea to win,
making it rain? Yes, I did see that. I saw that.
My favorite thing about the video isn't even the comedian getting up there and goes, Seth, this is for North Korea in 2026, and making it seem like it's being bought, and that's really funny and very topical right now. But if you watch the actual full video of that, my favorite thing in the entire world is Seth Blatter actually gets up and leaves where he's seated. They're getting ready for a press conference, gets up and moves over to the podium, which is on the right side of the screen, and he is so upset, you can see it on his face, and he goes, we have to clean this up, we have to clean this up. And the idea that FIFA, the level of corruption that has hit FIFA is so high that just the visual
bad
semblance
optics.
Of money.
Why did you use that one of your bad optics?
The bad optics.
That was total.
A $1 bill incorrectly positioned leaning up against his MacBook
That is so telling.
Would have so much effect on how that story was told.
That's a good point. How about that?
I didn't even catch that.
I saw the part about the throwing the money, but I didn't see that.
So that's my final sports nugget, is FIFA, here's the deal, and I think largely the governing body of FIFA has realized, hey, we got to fix this or we're going to lose.
Why would you watch it? It'd be like WWE. Why would you watch it?
You know, we had the Gold Cup, and here in the U.S., the CONCACAF Gold Cup, and teams were CONCACAF'd again, and bribes and corruption are running rampant. But FIFA, fix your game. You know, fix your game. That would be my parting. As a soccer fan, it's not that hard. I know money's important, and I appreciate that you guys make a lot of it. Fix your game, because you're going to start losing people. But
nobody's going to watch a rigged match.
I want to switch just a little bit and talk about a subject I almost know nothing about. But I do know that there's been one heck of a battle on Twitter between two...
you want to talk about Meek Mill and Drake?
Let's talk about Drizzy, as I believe he's called.
Drizzy.
And Meek Mill. What a good name for him right now. Meek Mill.
Oh, he's being destroyed, decimated in the rap world.
So it all started about a week ago, where Meek Mill went to Twitter and called out Drake for plagiarism or something.
Safari, who was a guy that was dating Nicki Minaj, is at the center of this thing. And I don't know. Nicki Minaj is... just one step short of Beyonce to African Americans and the hip hop world in general. So if Beyonce was the queen, Nicki Minaj is the princess, okay, in the hip hop world.
That's really sad.
Yeah, it's a telling state of affairs. But at any rate, Nicki Minaj is the hub in this spoke of
this. This is your subject. I just
Safari. I don't want to bore viewers with the details, but suffice it to say, a very popular rapper who is now dating Nicki Minaj was his manhood basically was challenged by another rapper who said,
is this your modern day equivalent of a duel?
Yeah, he's basically saying your woman is bigger than you. You open for her. She's the act. You're the opening act, and that she makes you. She makes more money than you. So you got an interesting dynamic in hip hop, which has a solid history of misogyny of men hating women. Here, for the first time, you have women in an ascendant role over her man, and it's basically it's true. And when Drake makes these statements, the adverse artist, who used to have an affair with Nicki Minaj, used to be his intimate partner with her, makes this comment that you are not even, she eclipses you. So it's a shot across the bow as far as men earning less than women now, which I think is a very interesting thing, because that's becoming more common. In couple and relationships, is that women are out earning their male counterparts. But then he's saying, he's making aspersions as to his penis length and saying that, Nicki said that you were kind of underperforming in that department compared. And it was just blowing up Twitter. I would imagine like the Ellen DeGeneres photo during the Oscars. I would imagine it had some effect like that. And Meek Mill, finally, the recipient of these dispersions, finally came back, and his response was less than stellar. And so Drake is the clear winner in this, on the hip-hop world. This is very popular right now, trending.
So I'm envisioning this old-fashioned duel that we were just talking about, and like,
Tupac and Biggie, big. I mean, somebody's going to get shot over this. My prediction. And speaking of predictions, I want to pat myself on the back for the prediction that I made back after the Ferguson riots, that body cameras and tasers, mandatory tasers in every department. I made that prediction in August of last year, And what do we know? This week, it was a body camera that saved a Cincinnati man from being accused of assaulting a police officer. And actually, come to find out that the officer killed this man, the purposeful killing of another murder of this man in a Cincinnati University cop pulled over a man, DeBowles is his name, shot him after questioning. And if it had not been for the body cam, the testimony from the other two cops.
Your elbow sore?
For patting myself on the back. I called it. Body cameras are good for race relations in America.
I don't deny that they are.
There would have been riots if this guy... Go ahead. I'm sorry. I'm done taking my victory lap.
So... In my echelon of the world, we don't really have a feud necessarily going on. The biggest story in my pop news would probably be Blake and Miranda, who cheated who, and so.
It was news to me that he stepped out on her. I always thought that she left him because he was stepping out on her. Robin Thicke type deal. The blurred lines. Damn, he screwed up. That girl was good looking.
I don't know enough about it. Obviously, I wasn't there for who stepped out on here, and it's probably less than important. But I think it.
Big news is Ice-T and Coco are gonna have a baby.
And yeah, I have no clue what that even means. So Joel, I try to get into your pop culture stuff. I really do. I just...
You don't find it interesting?
I really don't.
Well, we can't... You can't... You know, 31 flavors in the Baskin Robbins for a reason. 32, I think.
What's your favorite?
I like the pistachio almond. Or pistachio mint. Or what the one that green's got the nuts in it. I like that one.
I think we're kind of winding the day down. Right?
Well, I'm going to talk about pop stuff, but he doesn't follow it. If it's not country music, if it's not soccer, he's not interested.
That's not necessarily true, but if it's not a subject that I'm well versed in, I probably shouldn't talk. Ignorance.
Why not? It doesn't stop anybody else.
People will be PolitiFact checking me, and I'll be losing.
There was a Eagles linebacker that led police on a 143-mile-an-hour chase that may not be playing in the NFL anymore.
Former University of Missouri star.
Is that right?
Yeah.
What were the details on that? What happened?
I don't know, but for somebody that's been in a car that was going way too fast before.
143, that's quite an accomplishment.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I play Xbox, you know, we play some Xbox. There's a gamer points or achievements. You know, when you hit 110, I'm pretty sure, like, a light pops up on your dash. It's like, achievement earned. Achievement earned. You're now going two times the speed limit in 1982. You know, I don't know. Sheldon Richardson, my man, what are you thinking?
So is he out of the league now?
Oh, I mean, is anyone out of the league? I mean...
Ray Rice?
Think about another big story on that front is what's going to happen with...